Hello, friends and gamers. My name is GM Dave, your man behind the screen, and welcome back to our System Showcase revisit of Savage Worlds. In today's video, we'll be covering the basics of combat, which will include initiative, movement, attack rolls, damage rolls, how to determine damage, being shaken, and taking wounds, as well as how to soak wounds, and the key differences between wild cards and extra character types when it comes to combat. Before we get started, though, I'd like to remind everyone who's watching here on YouTube that there will be a pinned comment down below with links to all the new tech sites that I use, those being Odyssey, Rumble, and Minds.com. Going forward, you'll be able to find all of my content linked and backed up on those sites, as well as upcoming exclusives that won't be shared here on YouTube. So if you want access to all of my content, make sure you follow me through the links below. Down there, you will also find a link for Phoenix Rising, a fantasy adventure webcomic that I update monthly. If the prospect of a fantasy adventure with a touch of intrigue and romance and a heaping helping of heart appeals to you, please consider giving it a read, because I'm sure you're going to find it enjoyable. And with that done, let's begin our look at the basics of Savage Worlds combat, starting with initiative. Those of you who've watched my earlier video on the basics of the Savage Worlds system as a whole may remember me mentioning that in addition to a full set of gaming dice, you're also going to need a standard deck of playing cards with the jokers left in. Some of you may also recall that the character sheets includes no space for an initiative score like what you would see in D&D and Pathfinder. This is because Savage Worlds doesn't use dice to determine initiative, instead relying on said deck of cards, which is labeled the action deck. So how does this work? Quite easily, truth be told. Firstly, the GM deals out a single card to all the player characters. Then the GM deals out one card for each group of characters under his control, such as a horde of zombies, a pack of wolves, or a gang of bandits, for example. How the GM divides these groups is up to him. He can have his horde of 30 zombies all act on one turn, or break them down into smaller groups, such as 6 groups of 5, 3 groups of 10, and so on. However he decides to do this, though, he should remember that the goal here is to make running the battle as quick and easy as possible. So no, it's not a good idea to draw a card for each of the individual 30 zombies. He should also keep in mind that, generally speaking, wild card characters should be dealt their own cards. Remember, the player characters are wild cards as well. Generally speaking, the expectation is to deal the card face up, though dealing face down and having everybody reveal what they got all at once can be a very easy way to add some extra excitement to combat encounters without adding a significant amount of time. Regardless of how you choose to deal the cards, once they are dealt, the GM starts the round by beginning the countdown. Starting with aces and finishing with deuces, or twos if you prefer, each character or group will resolve its actions when their card comes up on the list. Taking face cards into account, where you act in combat would be as follows. Aces will start, followed then by the kings, queens, and jacks, and then counting down from tens all the way to twos at the bottom of the list. But what if two characters draw the same number? How's the tie broken? Well, ties are broken based on the suits, going in reverse alphabetical order. This would mean that in the event of a tie, spades would act first, followed then by hearts, and diamonds, and clubs last of all. Once the round is over, the GM will then deal out the next set of cards and repeat the process. Now you might be thinking, okay, so when do I shuffle the deck then? Well, that ties into the one card we haven't discussed yet, the Joker. Jokers will always add an extra flare of excitement when they show up, because anytime somebody draws the Joker, his character can go whenever he wants in that round, even if it interrupts another character's action. But that's not all. Any characters that draw a Joker also add +2 to all trait tests and damage rolls made that round too, making this a truly game-changing draw. It's also the GM's cue to shuffle the deck at the end of this round, so new GMs, make sure you keep this in mind. Whenever the Joker is drawn for initiative, you'll shuffle the deck at the end of that round. Now that we've covered initiative, it's time to move on to the meat of combat and look at movement and attack rolls. K Characters may move their full pace in a round. In most cases, this is going to be 6 inches. But be sure to double check and see if you have any edges or racial traits or even hindrances that will affect this. These should have already been taken into account during character creation, but it doesn't hurt to double check and make sure. Movement is considered to be a free action, and so it doesn't inflict a penalty on any other actions that you take in a turn, such as firing a weapon, casting a spell, or trying to taunt a foe. Attacks are separated into two types in most cases, melee and ranged. Melee attacks are those that are made in hand-to-hand combat. Trying to gut an enemy with your sword, run them through with your spear, bash them overhead with a chair, or simply even punching them in the face would all constitute melee attacks and would all be made using the fighting skill. To make a melee attack roll, your character first needs to be within reach of an enemy to strike them with a melee weapon. Note that some books are going to call these hand weapons, but these are the same thing. Now, usually this means you're going to have to be adjacent to the enemy you're attacking. So if you're playing with miniatures or if you're playing on a virtual tabletop, this means that, yeah, your piece and their piece or your token and their token, it's going to need to touch. Now, there are some exceptions to this, but those will be covered in a future video, such as the advanced combat rules when we talk about those, or the special rules regarding different types of weapons. Regardless, once your character is in range, you'll make a fighting roll against the target's parry score. If you meet or exceed his parry, congratulations, your hit lands. Ranged attacks are handled in much the same way as melee, but with a couple of exceptions. First of all, ranged attacks are made using the shooting skill, but unlike melee, they're not going to target the opponent's parry score. Instead, the target number for ranged attacks is 4. If you roll 4 or more on your shooting die, you hit. But sadly, it's not all roses for those who prefer to keep their distance and pick off their enemies from afar, because the further away you are from your target, the harder it's going to be to hit them. We'll cover the specifics of range increments in a future video, but for now, just remember this. You receive no penalty when firing at short range, which is the smallest increment on your weapon. Shots from medium range, however, which is the middle increment, will subtract 2 from your shooting roll, and long range shots, the last increment, will subtract 4 from your shooting roll. Regardless of whether you're attacking from melee or ranged, all wildcard characters should remember to roll their d6 wild die when they make these rolls. Again, don't forget players, this includes your characters. Remember, fighting and shooting are both skills, and so both are considered trait tests. This means all wildcards get to roll the wild die with your skill roll and take whichever die comes up higher. Now that we've covered the basics of making an attack, let's move on to look at how to figure out your damage when you hit. Unlike games like D&D and Pathfinder, Savage Worlds does not have a pool of health points for players to keep track of. Instead, damage is dealt and accumulated based on a number of wounds the characters can take. All wildcard characters can take 3 wounds before they become incapacitated. Extras, however, are incapacitated after receiving just 1 wound. But how exactly are wounds taken and how is damage dealt in Savage Worlds? Similarly to how you determine success or failure by rolling against a character's parry when making a fighting roll for melee combat, damage is determined by rolling a weapon's damage against a victim's toughness with 3 possible outcomes. Failure, success, or a raise. If you don't match your opponent's toughness, your attack ends in failure and you deal no damage. Success comes from when you match or beat the victim's toughness by up to 3 points. This character is now shaken, or if he was already shaken, he takes a wound and remains shaken. A raise happens when you exceed the victim's toughness score by 4 or more, and that will happen again with every 4 additional points above that. Once again, the victim is shaken, but they will also take a wound for each raise on the damage roll. Now, all of this is well and good, of course, but what does any of this actually mean? Well, let's take a look at an example to break this down. Let's say Robert E. Howard's famed Puritan Solomon Kane is facing down a band of brigands after sneaking into their hideout. With his rapier in his right hand and a flintlock in his left, he begins listing the crimes he plans to bring these men to zealous justice for. However, while he speaks, a brigand with 5 toughness moves to attack Solomon, but Solomon catches him off guard and acts first. He successfully shoots the brigand with his flintlock pistol, so he rolls 2d6 plus 1 damage, the damage listed under the flintlock. He rolls a 2 and a 5, making his total damage 8. 2 plus 5 plus 1 comes to 8. Since his victim's toughness is 5, Solomon beat the brigand's toughness by a total of 3 points. That brigand is now shaken. While this is happening, a toughness 4 brigand rushes Solomon with a dagger and misses. In response, Solomon thrusts with his rapier, dealing his strength plus d4 damage. His strength is an impressive d10, so for the melee weapon, he rolls 1d10 plus 1d4. His d4 comes up as a 3, and the d10 comes up as a whopping 9. That's 12 damage against the brigand's 4 toughness, beating it by 8 and giving Solomon's attack 2 raises. Remember, every 4 points above the target number is a raise. The dagger-wielding brigand is now shaken and immediately suffers 2 wounds, incapacitating him. But what about the effects of damage itself? What do wounds, the shaken status, and incapacitation actually mean and do? Starting with being shaken, characters become shaken if the damage of the attack is a simple success. This means they matched or were up to 3 points over the target's toughness. Shaken represents when a character is rattled, distracted, or dealing with momentary shock during combat. The character isn't fully stunned, but he is suppressed enough that he needs to recompose himself to become effective again. Shaken characters must use their actions to attempt to recover from being shaken by attempting a spirit roll. And reminder, the normal target number for tests like this is 4. If a character fails his spirit roll, he remains shaken, can only perform free actions, and must attempt another spirit roll the next round. If he succeeds his roll, meaning he beats the roll by up to 3 points, he is no longer shaken, but can still only perform free actions for this round. However, if the character raises, which means he beats the roll by 4 or more points, he is no longer shaken and may act as normal on this round. Wounds, on the other hand, are handled a little bit differently. Characters will receive wounds either when a damage roll against them raises, or if they're already shaken when a future damage roll is a simple success. Extras are removed from play when they take a wound. They are considered to be dead, injured, or otherwise incapacitated and are so removed from the fight. Wildcard characters, which again includes the player characters, can take 3 wounds and still function. But if they take any additional wounds after the 3rd one, they become incapacitated. Note that wildcard characters can never actually have more than 3 wounds. Any wounds they take beyond 3 mean that they have 3 wounds and are incapacitated. Wounds also incur penalties in their own right. Each wound that a wildcard character suffers gives a stacking -1 penalty to his pace, though this can't be reduced below 1, and to all further trait tests. This means having 1 wound gives a -1 penalty, 2 gives -2, and 3 gives -3. Finally, as noted earlier, once a wild card receives more than 3 wounds, he becomes incapacitated. Incapacitated characters aren't necessarily dead, but they're generally too injured to do anything useful. Incapacitated characters cannot perform actions and are not dealt action cards for initiative in combat. As noted earlier, incapacitated extras are removed from play entirely. When a wild card becomes incapacitated, though, he must make an immediate vigor roll. Note that this is a trait test, so the penalties from your wounds will apply. If the total of this roll is 1 or less, the character dies, and you will need to roll a new character. If you roll a failure, meaning you don't meet the target number of 4, you will roll on the injury table and begin bleeding out. Now, we will cover both the injury table and what bleeding out is in the next installment, the advanced combat rules. If you roll a success, you will again roll on the injury table, but the injury will go away when all your wounds are healed. Finally, if you raise on the roll, you will once again roll on the injury table, but the injury will go away either within 24 hours or when all your wounds are healed, whichever comes first. Now, all of this may sound quite grim for the wild cards out there, but Fortunately for them, luck, as represented by Benny's, is never too far from their side. One of the most useful things wildcard characters may spend their Bennies on is immediately overcoming the shaken condition. This can be done at any time, even if they just failed a spirit roll to recover from being shaken. Furthermore, characters may also spend a Benny to soak a damaging roll. To do this, you turn the Benny in when an attack would deal enough damage to cause a wound and make an immediate vigor roll. For every success and raise on the roll, you reduce the number of wounds suffered from that attack by one. What's more, if you soak all the wounds from an attack, you both prevent and may even remove the shaken condition as well. For example, after dispatching the brigands that tried to attack him, Solomon Kane is stabbed from behind by a brigand he wasn't aware was hiding in a nearby alcove. The damage against him raises twice, so it would cause two wounds. His player decides to spend a Benny to soak the roll and rolls a d10 vigor. He rolls an 8, beating the target number of 4 with a raise. This means he has one success and one raise, so he soaks both wounds from the attack. Since all the wounds have been soaked, this prevents the shaken condition as well. And with that, friends and gamers, we have now covered the basics of combat in Savage Worlds. While this doesn't touch on all of the finer points of the system, it should cover the core elements that you need to know to understand how Savage Worlds' combat system works on the fundamental level. Remember, 2 weeks from today, I'll be uploading my video on the more advanced aspects of combat, so make sure to keep an eye out for that to learn more about things such as different movement types, how to gain bonus damage on your attacks, and the effects of acing a roll. In the meantime, please feel free to like the video if you enjoyed it, subscribe if you'd like to see more, and comment down below with your thoughts. Do you feel like you now have a basic understanding of the way Savage Worlds combat works, or are there things that you're still not entirely sure about? Let me know in the comments down below, and remember, friends and gamers, in the world of tabletop gaming, you don't want to just sit back and watch. Get in there and game. Have a good one. We'll be right back.